Hi everybody, I'm here again with Jude Montague and we're going to have a sizzling talk about electricity. But I wanted to just start first with a Gurdjieff quote. And he says, in the opinion of Beelzebub, man's extraction of electricity from nature and its destruction during its use is one of the chief causes of the shortening of the life of man. And Gurdjieff goes on to say later that he says that we use electricity in the modern day in the wrong way. Whereas you've got some, you know, like we don't use it for beneficial means. So, Jude, this is what something you wanted to talk about.
Well, yeah, I'm really interested in how people have thought about electricity for ages, about the health benefits. I've got a little song we're hopefully going to play a bit later about John Wesley and his excitement about the idea of this new technology and how it's going to be applied to people for health benefits. But what just gets me about electricity is the fact it's everywhere. It's in us all, electrons, electricity. So it's about how we harness it. We're already living with it. It's already powering the universe. It's the fabric of the universe. It's the force of the universe.
Yeah, we have an electromagnetic
and
vibration.
I think we sometimes think that, oh, electricity just is only when you turn on the mains and you turn on the light switch and it's only the big generated sources of electricity. But of course, it's inside us and it's inside the planet and it's inside the universe. And I think Tesla, didn't he? I was going to just say about Tesla, who you are a great researcher and writer about Nikola Tesla and his ideas about electricity. And he had many ideas about the numerology and the forces of the universe and how we can harness all that power.
Because he said if we understood the 3, 6, and 9, we would understand everything. And, you know, I'm assuming he's looking at the cosmology and how the forces come down to us and whether they're at a certain vibrational frequency. And I think he understood that different vibrations or the hertz of the frequency of the electricity, how it can affect a person, whether it's for a healing. You know, of today, obviously, we know about electric shock treatment. So people have realized that it could be used for the brain. And also it can be used for killing. We've got the electric chair, which horrified Tesla. They used his electrical system to use it for death, for the death penalty. So this...
That was a terrible thing to do to an inventor.
Yes, and he was shocked when Edison used his... Edison was trying to obviously poo-poo Tesla because he wanted his system, which was the DC system, where... Tesla made the AC-DC system, so it's alternating current. And Edison used to go on a show around America, killing dogs with Tesla's system. And at one point, an elephant, which broke Tesla's heart because he loved animals so much. But Edison was trying to do it as a shock to the peoples to say, look what this does to animals. It could do this to you. But he was obviously using it, Edison, to such a high frequency that it could kill.
It's just a terrible thing to do to someone as well. What a terrible, in so many ways, business practice, violent cruelty about animals. I think he was trying to do it to show that AC was more dangerous, but in actual fact, DC is more dangerous. It was Tesla's system that was more dangerous because with AC, at least you get a chance of being thrown off and being thrown across the room because it switches and it can flip you away.
Whereas Tesla was the AC-DC. Tesla gave us AC-DC and Edison gave us DC. So, but yeah, you're right. It is the alternating current is more protective of us all. So, but
yeah,
it's the vibration of it, isn't it? And the frequency of it, of as to whether it's beneficial or not. And you were saying about John Wesley. Is he the same guy that started that church? I've forgotten.
Yeah, he's the Methodist guy. So he's a preacher. And the song that we'll play later has some of his quotes in it. And he believed that, he wanted obviously to help people because he had altruistic ideas. And he believed in divine help, and he thought that electricity was an absolute gift, and being able to harness it for the good of how people were. And people were using it for health purposes, and he was at the front with these thinkers, and he was curing pain to using it, small electric shocks to cure pain. And that's something that we still do quite a bit if we don't want to take medicine. Sometimes you'll put those small electric shocks in your across an area that's feeling pain in order to help break the pain circuit. It's really because it resets the nerves, isn't it, that they talk to each other, they communicate to the area of pain in the brain, they communicate through electrical and an electrical neural network, and the giving small electrical signals breaks that message.
Well, that's part of what acupuncture is as well, when they put the needles in, the Chinese, because they've understood where all the node points are in the body. And they say that a lot of pain is because, like what you're saying, it's that electrical magnetic charge that's going through us has gone off kilter and is going in the wrong way, or knocking something it shouldn't be, or nerves touching another nerve. So they're like grounding it by putting them needles in us to get the current flowing through us correctly.
Yeah, and resetting, I think that with the electric shocks, with the very small electric shocks, they reset the nervous system. They give it a chance to reset in a more healthy way, or perhaps they just give you a respite from pain for a little bit by giving these little sort of breaths inside it. Yeah, I think it's very interesting that Tesla said 3, 6, and 9 as well, because I'm very interested in Babylonian mathematics, not so much to do with electricity, but Tesla thought it was related. So I think it's fair enough to talk about it now. Yeah. 3, 6, and 9 and those numbers, and the Babylonian system that was about, it's all that sexagesimal system. Everything's divided into 6, divided into 9. And it does seem particularly a useful system for when you're marking out things on a circle, like time. It's survived in our culture because it's so good for doing a clock, which is the circle of time as it goes around. And also for geometry, 360 degrees, all these ways of counting. Obviously, we've got dozens in many ways. It's survived in many ways, but the places where we really still see it are often to do with circular and movement and force, like the movement of time and the circle that is there for geometry. Because with geometry, all the lines, all the angles come into one point, and you know that all the degrees that must add up to 360. So it's proved really useful for things that are cyclical. And I think Tesla would say, of course, because that's why they're magical. It's the same kind of thing. It's the division of the circle.
And the circle is not just in what you're saying with geometry, and I think even with an electrical current, it's going round from the conductor to wherever it's supposed to be going, and then it goes back round again, like we were talking about the alternating. But I find it interesting.
Yeah, and the electron round the nucleus.
That's it, yeah.
The orbit of the planet. Yeah, in actual fact, though, although the electrons do travel, they say that it's not really that one electron is kind of going around. That's a kind of a simplistic diagram for electricity. It's more that there is an electric field that when a certain voltage happens, so a certain condition really sets off, there's a field around the wire, and that's when the electricity is moving. So it's not that one electron is going through the whole system like on a journey like we would be. It's more that there's a sort of a circular state that's set off when the voltage is applied to something through which electrons can travel fast, like metal.
Because in the old days, I think what Gurdjieff was attaining to was in the ancient times, the let's say the ancient Egyptians, the ancient Babylonians or whoever, they understood what you was just saying about the field. They knew how to manipulate it in such a way that it was could be used for various things. I think this is what they used to obviously create light still, but they didn't need light bulbs because they managed to be able to vibrate the frequency so a natural light came from the electricity. Because I know that sounds a bit crazy, but we don't really know what electricity is. We know how to create it, but we just know it's a force, don't we?
It's so fundamental, so I guess we can't understand it. It's sort of almost too fundamental to understand with. We can sort of look at how it works and we know a lot about it, but I think it's so fundamental, like a fundamental law, that it's we only can sort of describe. And we've done very well with science at getting into the how of things. I mean, I think mathematics is incredible into, what is it being, isn't it? It's the language of things. That's what people say sometimes. It's sort of the language that makes things behave in the way they behave.
Yeah, they can put mathematical quotations to things, because a lot of electricity is all down to maths, if you understand maths. But what do you think of like this electric universe theory? Do you know that, about how it's the whole universe is really run on electricity and magnetism and plasma, and not how the scientists of today are now saying it?
Yeah, I don't know too much, but I mean, there is electricity and that force in everything. Even the scientists say that's, I mean, even today's scientists, they're always talking about that, how their model of the atom works and how it's, magnetism and electricity affect the state of things, that just the existence of things.
Yeah, so the different frequencies would make them in different ways. So this must be what Wesley was aware of. How did he come across electricity then?
I think he was just doing the rounds at the time. It was very fashion. When I say fashionable, I don't mean like a dress is fashionable, but it was what people were talking about at the time.
They used to have electricity parties. Didn't they? Because that's the 1700s, isn't it? Wesley.
Yes, it is. The 1700s. And he obviously thought, well, I'll bring it into my vision of the universe, which is a divine vision. So for him, it fitted in with his model of how he saw everything, which was obviously very, in a way, a traditional Christian view. Even though he was changing things, there was still this idea of the God and the Bible and the ethics of Christianity that he was promoting as he saw it. So he brought electricity into all that. But at the same time, it's so interesting because he is he's there, he's experimenting. He's like an inventor. He's trying things out on his congregation in order to, that are having problems and that coming to him with health problems. And you'd think, being a priest or a vicar or whatever, what do they call it in the Methodist church? But anyway, their spiritual leader, you'd think he would be talking to them, because we're so used to spiritual leaders nowadays just sort of talking cures or listening cures, or maybe giving people some word, or have a prayer or do some good works or anything like that. But no, he actually put the electric electrodes on them, and he had one bit that's in the song which I mentioned. One of his parishioners came to him and had electroshock by him, and four times he applied it and to cure her pain, four times,
and it worked.
Yeah, apparently. Well, it says, he said so. Yeah,
so maybe notes, the frequency wasn't right the first few times, or maybe it needed a few volts. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe you need a few times anyway, repeated, but I don't know. But he was trying to help people, and he thought electricity was very good for that. And lots of other people did too, and they still do. People still do. It's just not really the dumb thing anymore to shock yourself in order to cure pain, apart from in very small small areas. But you know, maybe there's more benefits than we nowadays. I think we think ECT is all, it's very frightening, and we have that terrible image of it because it looks very scary with people when they go in the theatre when it's administered, and they have things put in their mouth to stop them biting their tongue, and the electrodes are on the brain and everything. But there are some people who do say that it is actually was a very beneficial therapy that we no longer use now for when people are very depressed or suicidal, because it resets the nerves. I don't know anything about it, but because I don't know anything about it, that's no reason to think that some of the people who are very pro it, you know, that just to have a single biased approach to it. I don't really know. And I feel like we should be, the benefits of electricity.
Well, I know some people that have worked with it, and they say what the problem is with, you know, the doctors in the past was they were doing too high a voltage. You need to have it. And you know, I sometimes wonder if these kind of doctors love to be electrocuting everybody. It needed to be done in a obviously a lower voltage to, like you say, reset the brain. Too much is going to frizz out other parts of the brain that you probably still need. But in a shorter voltage, it would probably, because it does give you a bit of a thrill when you get a little bit of an electric shock, you know, if it's a little teeny weeny one. And in the 1700s, they used to have electricity parties. You know, it started off obviously with the rich having their electricity parties, and it filtered down over the years to the, you know, in the parlor. It was a parlor game, and there was a man, I can't remember what his technical term was, but they'd call him up, he'd come to the party, set up the electric device, which would be a platform with a conductor and a an on-off switch, and people would stand on the platform. He'd switch it on and they'd get a little woo shock. And everybody, because nobody had ever experienced anything like that. So they used to have these parties where everybody went around to be like slightly electrocuted, having a little party trick. And then they started putting them into dresses for some reason, which didn't last long. And I'll tell you why in a moment. But the reason they put them into dresses was because apparently when the dress was given the electrical vibration through the dress, it made a woman's face, you know, have her rosy cheeks. But the reason they had to get rid of them is because one day a lady peed herself in her dress and electrocuted herself dead, which I shouldn't be laughing at. But anyway,
that fashion
was got rid of. But that was all in the 1700s. So it was seen as a bit of fun, electricity, rather than using it for what we use it for now, to power the lights and keep us warm and power the computers and such like.
We're really reliant on it now, but just it's part of the fabric of how we live now to have it so controllable and to be able to power up what we want to power when we want to, that grid of electrical power that we have running all the time. We're so reliant on it. And in actual fact, now when there's a threat to it being in short supply, everybody's really frightened of it being taken away.
Well, I suppose also with the difference of what Tesla was doing, he was trying to get the electricity out of the atmosphere, where most of the businesses that give us electricity now are creating their own through their machines and storing it in their, you know, their electrical storehouses or whatever, in the factories.
Their batteries, yeah
that's batteries. Tesla was trying to bring it out of the air. He believed, like what you were saying right at the beginning, everything's got electricity in it. And then he went through a phase of trying to bring it up through the earth, which did work, but it took a lot of took a very big tower to make that happen, to generate the energy. Because it's a much gentler electrical vibration going through the earth.
Yeah, I think on the nuclear power stations, which are obviously people are frightened of nuclear power because it can go wrong so easily if there is obviously like an earthquake or whatever, and the nuclear radiation gets into around people, isn't it? It causes all sorts of complications for human cells or cells in the environment. But I think how they work is, I used to think, oh, they're making the electrons through the nuclear fission, but I think it's actually much more basic than that. I think they just drive turbines. It's just that it gives off so much energy when you do nuclear fission and nuclear fusion that they use that energy, they it's all encased, and that energy drives turbines. So it's actually a very conventional mechanism that actually turns it into the electricity that we get. It's still the old turbine, the magnets whizzing around the wire. It's the metal coil and the magnet. It's the same old thing.
But why does it then? Because the reason I think nuclear is so bad is if it does go wrong, it then creates that radiation, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's the energy source, isn't it? Yeah. Of the electricity. But when the electricity comes out, it's the same as any old electricity. It's generated in the same way, apparently. I always sort of imagined, I never really looked into it, but I sort of imagined, oh, somehow the nuclear energy, the electricity is different. But
no,
apparently, no, it's just an energy creation. And then that energy gets turned into electricity through the old wire and magnet trick.
Right, so it's how they've made it, how they've created it. Though I do remember an old joke that, you know, we've had quite a few nuclear disasters, but there's still no mutant superheroes out there from the radiation.
Yeah, no, which shows you can.
Sorry,
you can, as long as you've got energy, you can make electricity from the energy by that mechanism, by wire and magnets, and that's that field generating that field. And again, it's circular, isn't it? It's turning around. That's what does it, because it's the magnet turning around and the coil of wire. It's just all that circular spinning thing again. And then when you see the diagrams of electricity, again, it's, isn't it, it's that sort of circular, the circular pattern that it follows. You know, when you spread the iron filings on the magnets, do that at school, and then it makes that shape, and it's like a magical shape. It's that invisible shape that the electrons are taking, and that's the field.
I find it interesting that electricity flows, and they call it a current. You know, it's like a river current. It flows along. Mm. So if it's a continuously moving energy, does it ever stop, or does it turn into something else as it goes further along? You know, if it's being used, it's obviously turning into powering, you know, like this laptop that I'm looking at you from. But the electricity that's out of the world and the universe, I'm wondering what that's doing. Is that, as it's going along round, does it affect everything in a subtle way? You know, like they say that the, yeah, go on. What do you think?
I think it's because of the way they talk about electricity that makes us think these things that's not quite right. And they know it's not quite right, but they use it as a way of explaining how circuits work. It's basically about how we harness electricity. That's what the sort of model is for, so that we can say we can use electricity by having these wires and these circuits, and then the electricity moves around. But that's not really how it works. And they know that isn't how it works. That's like the simple model they give you to understand how we harness electricity. But actually what it is it's an electrical field. It isn't actually a pipe with electrons going around as much as it's an electrical field. So when you turn it on, when the circuit is initiated, it's joined up and it's a circle again.
Yep.
And it's turned on, what happens is there's a field that's created around the wire. It's not an electron going buzz, really. It's a field. And then everything's suddenly in motion in this world of electricity. Suddenly they're in like their electrical state. And then when it's turned off, and the whatever is driving the electrical field, the voltage, which is voltage, because it's like a build-up, an inequality. So when the artificial inequality is turned off, everything goes sort of back to its normal state. But it's like it turns into an electrical state when you flick the switch rather than it's
natural state.
It's an electrical field.
I've always liked it, like, because you used to have, well, I know you still have all your organs, musical organs, instruments. And I remember when we came to your studio once and you started switching all the organs on, and you could hear the buzz of electricity at first, and then as they warmed up, before you've even played them, you can hear it all crackling away. I love that.
Yeah, because it's old, so there's dust, and so things are sort of almost burning out with when the electrical state goes through. It's like, oh, the dust is like sort of fizzing away, and it gets burnt away with the heat because there's all the heat that's emitted. And that's actually really interesting when it comes to all the light bulbs, and what Edison did as well is with the light bulb, all that tech development, that some people really say that you should really think of those early light bulbs as being heat emitting things, because they give off so much more heat, electricity, those early ones, rather than light.
Yeah.
So the light is a byproduct, really, almost of it heating up. And LEDs, obviously, they're called LEDs because they don't emit heat. They're only emitting light. So therefore, that's why they're much more, they just spend less electricity.
So it's like a cold light. That's fantastic. I've never thought of it like that before. But as you're saying it, but yeah, of course it is. It seems so simple. But I've never thought that through before, but that's great.
Yeah, and it's really interesting, isn't it? I mean, I think it's so fundamental. We don't even, because we're just given these new things without really being told. It's not like that we've had some information campaign to go, right, this is what, and just get on with it, don't you?
Yeah, they don't want us to know about it. But
If you want to look it up, you can now with the way information is getting around, but only if you want to. It's not kind of there, is it? I mean, they give us all kinds of news on these things that you're trying to. If you want to know about Meghan and Harry, you can know everything about that or not or whatever. But they don't tell you about light emitting diodes.
Yeah, they don't want to give you stuff that you can learn from. They just want to keep you dumbed down. But I do remember as kids. Yeah. Because this is something me and a friend was talking about recently. They don't have the safety programs anymore. But I'm sure you remember when we were kids and we had the children's TV was between, I think it was 4 and 6 o'clock in the evenings. But in between the programs, they'd have little safety cartoons of, you know, don't go and put your hands in the plug socket and things like that. Because electricity is dangerous.
Yeah, we were talking about this the other day, how you don't get government so many of these things anymore. We used to have one that said, eat more mushrooms and go to work on an egg, didn't they? And these ones.
Yeah, but... not magic mushrooms. Sorry, don't eat magic mushrooms. Yeah. But it isn't, because as a child, I don't know why children are, and I see it still now. Children just want to put their fingers in them plug sockets. So that electricity must be calling them. Come play with me.
Yeah, I think it's a little hole, isn't it, in the wall. I mean, it's tempting, isn't it? But just to get back, because I'm absolutely fascinated by this use of the number 3, 6, 9, and Tesla and electricity and his thoughts about that. I've just always been so in love with Babylonian maths, or what we call that, with the circle and the divisions. And I don't know, people don't seem to think about it so much, but I'm always in wonder with it. And also this idea of maths as a placement that you get with it, the idea that a point, instead of adding things up sequentially with like that could be anything, you get this sort of restriction by having a mathematics that's about placing a point in on the circle and seeing where that is in relation to the rest of the of the circular mathematical space. And it seems also so interesting that it's stayed for how we use astronomy, certainly in a layperson's way, because of the we've got the constellations that people still are very keen on, the astrological division of the heavens into the 12 sections, and it seems to really resonate with human beings and that form of cosmic math.
Absolutely. I think it's very important to people, I stress it quite a lot in my shows, go and sort out your astrological chart so you can know more about yourself. But the Babylonian astrology is not that different to the Western. Well, it is, but at the same time, it's still the same characteristics to them. But what they, because I find the numerology in astrology quite difficult. That's why I never became an astrologer. I can't work out all the different angles and everything. But it, you know, if you understand all that, then you understand the universe.
I think it's a way of mapping the sky as well, which is always up there. And now I think you're going for a night walk, and we will too, to look up at the stars. And I think all the planets are around at the moment, moving through the wanderers, wandering through the starry, the more fixed, apparently fixed stars.
Yeah, last week was, I think it was on the 28th, because we're recording this on the 2nd of January. Yeah, I think it was the 28th last week, was one of the few times you could see all the planets in the sky at once. That doesn't happen that often because of the way they're all moving at different speeds around. But I recommend to everyone, go out for a night walk. But if you can, go and see the stars. It is amazing. I know many of you can go, oh, I live in the cities. Well, when you do get out into the country or whatever, go and just look at the stars. So you need a clear night, obviously. But we are going to run out of time soon, Jude. So I wanted to say thank you very much. But also, you've got your new album out. Have you guys got a website or is it just the YouTube channel?
I'll let you know when it's out properly. But yeah, we're on Bandcamp if everybody wants to check out Montague Armstrong. And I'll tell you all about the electrical organs another time, because our music is powered by electricity, electromagnetism, and the wonders of it.
Oh, I know, and that'd be good to do. Yeah. Oh, I love your organs album. Yeah. So
have a look at the inside. I can broadcast to everybody straight from the bowels of our studio, and we can have a look inside as we go at the
That'd be excellent.
Or maybe we'll do it when you come down. Anyway, whatever. It'd be great to share some of this technology with everybody.
Yeah. Right. Well, because we're going to run out of time. So thank you very much, Jude. Thank you, everybody, for listening. And check out Jude's song, which hopefully I've attached properly to the end of this video. Thanks, Jude.
Thank you. Good night. Yeah.